lectures, we have analyzed the forecasting process and the different methodologies that can be used to forecast the future demand. Now we want to focus on the forecasting accuracy. How can we measure forecasting accuracy? And what is the optimal forecasting accuracy? We can be interested in monitoring the accuracy of the forecasting process for multiple reasons. First of all, to choose the best fitting forecasting technique in order to have limited forecast errors. Then, to set the parameters of the selected technique. For example, when we have analyzed the implementation process of the old Winters method, we have seen that the smoothing coefficients alpha, beta, and gamma should be chosen in order to minimize the forecast errors. Moreover, after some time has passed, increasing forecast errors can help understand that we need to review the technique or the parameters. In order to monitor the accuracy of the forecasting process, we can use multiple indicators. But first of all, we need to define how to measure the forecast errors. The forecast error at time t can be defined as the difference between the real value of the demand and the forecasted value at time t. Therefore, the forecast error can be positive if the actual demand is higher than the forecast, or negative if the actual demand is lower than the forecast. Based on the measurement of the forecast errors, we can introduce two sets of indicators. In fact, some of them attempt to measure the distortion, whereas others focus on the consistency. Let's start with the indicators measuring the distortion. The most adopted one is the mean error. The mean error is very easy to compute, since we just need to take the average of the forecast errors in a defined time horizon, that is, n periods. If the mean error is negative, it means that the real demand is usually lower than the forecast. Please pay attention to the fact that if the mean error is equal to zero, it does not mean that we do not have forecast errors. In fact, we are not able to distinguish a situation in which we do not have errors from another situation in which we have sometimes positive errors, sometimes negative errors that sum to zero. That's why we need to use distortion indicators together with consistency indicators. As for the consistency, we can introduce three main indicators: the mean absolute deviation, the mean absolute percentage error, and the standard deviation error. The mean absolute deviation, MAD, is similar to the mean error, but it considers the absolute value of the errors and evaluates the average. This means that positive and negative errors do not cancel out. However, if the MAD is high, we cannot understand if we are underestimating or overestimating the demand. So once again, we see that it is important to combine the evidences got from distortion and consistency indicators. Moreover, the mean absolute deviation does not provide any information regarding the magnitude of the errors compared to the value of the demand. For example, we find a MAD equal to 100 pieces. Is it good or not? It probably depends on the real value of the demand. This is a very low performance if the demand is equal to 200 pieces, whereas it is a much better performance if the demand is equal to 10,000 pieces. In this regard, an interesting indicator is the mean absolute percentage error, MAPE. This indicator compares the absolute error in period t with the real demand in t, and then takes the average of the percentage errors. Similar to the mean absolute deviation, we do not have any indication about the type of error, that is, if we are underestimating or overestimating the demand. But it is useful to better understand the relative magnitude of the errors. Another consistency indicator that is widely used is the standard deviation error, SDE, that is the sample standard deviation of the forecast errors. The pros and cons of these indicators are similar to those related to the mean absolute deviation. But in this case, bigger errors weigh more, since we are taking the square errors. So it is useful when the seriousness of the errors increase significantly with the absolute value of the errors. After having analyzed the main indicators used to assess the accuracy of the forecasting process, it is useful to spend some words on how we can set the target value of these indicators. Differently from what we can think, generally the goal is not to reach zero errors. On the contrary, our goal should be to minimize the total costs, which depend on the costs related to forecast errors, but also on the costs related to the management and implementation of the forecasting process. In fact, in order to reduce the forecast errors, we usually need to invest more in the forecasting process. Therefore, we have to understand which is the best trade-off between these two types of costs. In this lecture, we have seen the importance of the forecasting accuracy, and we have analyzed the main indicators used to assess the forecast errors.